Many of you may think it strange that I should be standing here in order to speak about a man who died almost a year before I was born, in a distant country, who was one of the chief architects of Britain leaving India, who took tea with my great-grandfather wearing just a loincloth and sandals, and who succeeded where no one else had in helping to replace my grandfather's title of Emperor of India with that of head of the Commonwealth. And yet, just before the transfer of power, when the engagement of my parents was announced in 1947, one of the first messages the Viceroy received was from Mahatma Gandhi. It asked for his best wishes to be conveyed to them. Later, he regretted he could send no wedding present because he had no personal possessions beyond his sandals and dhoti and a cheap watch on a piece of string. However, Lord Mountbatten suggested he might make something, and he duly set to work on his spinning wheel to produce a small tablecloth. This was sent, together with a magnificent diamond necklace, from the Nizam of Hyderabad to Buckingham Palace. Recently, the British Museum asked to include the cloth in their Gandhi exhibition, but it could be found nowhere until the Queen produced it from a place where some of her most treasured belongings are kept. It does indeed seem strange to me, and yet if Mahatma Gandhi had lived to 125, as he hoped, I doubt it would have seemed strange to him. But having heard so much from the last Viceroy about Gandhi's life, and being fascinated by India herself, I am honored to speak in the memory of a man who achieved such astonishing things for India, without bitterness or hostility, and who, by his own magnetic personality, prevented the terror of bloodshed in Bengal. How fortunate was India to have a man like that at one of the most critical periods in her history, when the situation was so tense that civil war throughout the whole subcontinent could so easily have flared up. Gandhi himself acknowledged that he was a revolutionary, some said the greatest of his time, but he qualified it by saying he was a non-violent revolutionary. He understood people and loved them as human beings, as could be seen from his campaign for the untouchables. And this became inescapably obvious to nearly all Indians and also to a great number of other people in and out of India. With the death of Gandhi, it was as if a great restraining influence had been removed. The prophet had been murdered, and his message began to die away, as did the embers of his funeral pyre. Today, violent methods seem to be taken for granted in many organizations. The excuse is frequently that all else has failed, and that institutional violence must be met with a similar response. The reaction is exactly that of a spoilt child, which has not been allowed its own way. It sulks briefly, and then turns on its parents. All this does in most cases is to infuriate the parents and make the latter's determination somewhat stronger to discipline the child. I know that violent techniques are used in demonstrations on behalf of worthy causes and causes that may require fighting for. But that fighting should be directed with perseverance against people's minds rather than their bodies and possessions. In certain aspects, violence appears to be totally self-defeating. We have seen it used more and more frequently, and I do not believe for one moment it is a satisfactory substitute for a more civilized approach. It is often the typical thug's or coward's reaction to a situation, even if that situation contains an element of so-called police brutality. It is only too easy to use ostensibly peaceful methods to provoke or induce violence. And this is done continually to the forces of law in almost every country in the world. I personally can see no point whatsoever in using unnecessary and utterly barbaric force. All it does is to set people's minds more firmly against the perpetrators. Gandhi, by his fasts and disobedience campaigns, engendered sympathy throughout India and indeed the world. There are many causes at the moment for which people feel, rightly or wrongly, desperately anxious. I myself have discovered in a small way that it is perseverance that counts, even if you are frustrated 10 or 20 times over. In the course of your persistence, you probably touch human susceptibilities of sympathy and appreciation. And if uncalled for violence is met with a passive resistance, that sympathy will increase in leaps and bounds. Those against whom you are persevering are, after all, only human, and eventually something will crack. The consequent sense of achievement is overwhelming, and it is far easier to justify something obtained legitimately and peacefully than brutally and senselessly. The only trouble about this is that it requires effort, willpower, and self-discipline. Some would have us believe these are out-of-date concepts, but as long as man has an ounce of humanity left and remembers the example of Gandhi, they will survive. If only for Mahatma Gandhi's sake, on this the centenary of his birth, let us show with concerted courage that honorable people exist in vast numbers who refuse to see why barbaric violence should exist in what we optimistically call our civilizations. Let us remember also that we are here tonight to pay tribute to a great man and above all a great Indian, who never contemplated the severance of that bond of long association and friendship between Britain and India. Mahatma Gandhi ka samankane ke liye aaj Britain aur Bharat ikate hue hai. We honor that friendship tonight.